They need it for pain. But now they're in prison and there are other people who are walking over free, coming on TV saying, I'm going to make $12 million this year in selling marijuana. Where's the moral persuasion in that?
Mm-hmm. No, I agree with you 100%. There's actually, I think, about three states now, maybe four, that legalize marijuana, one of them being Colorado, the other one being Alaska. And then our backyard, Washington, D.C., has legalized marijuana. And I think it's interesting because, you know, right where these laws are being made, they legalize something like marijuana where they're saying, hey, you can't, you know, do marijuana in the street, but you are legally, you can do it inside your home. And then you start to think, well, why would, you know, people approve that? And I think the one word for that is simply taxes, money. The government has a high levy, high taxes on marijuana. And Colorado being the first state that did this, the government made millions and millions of dollars in taxes for legalizing marijuana. And the truth of the matter is, I feel money, unfortunately, you know, you hear that saying, the root of all evil, definitely holds a factor in why certain things are done. I mean, we can also talk about alcohol. You know, alcohol was at one point illegal in the United States. And, you know, during a certain time, the government said, okay, we're going. Would you say, Michelle, that's the moral dangerous substances?
I think it's immoral.
Yeah, we could definitely talk about the government and you know, their influences and how they affect different things in society. You know, I mean, they are the government. You know, we're the only species that have to pay taxes to live, you know, on the earth. I mean, human beings in general. And, you know, the government collects this money. And, of course, they say they use it for all of the different things we have, you know, being that, you know, public services, schools, police departments. And other things that, you know, for us to really research and figure that out would be pretty, you know, extensive. So, you know, I can understand what people are saying with the government being immoral, because unfortunately things do occur. So, you know, with that said, we all have a moral obligation. If we see somebody, you know, for example, there was an accident that took place across the street and people are hurt, you know, our moral obligation is to try to help that person, if possible. You know, if you're in a situation where you can't, for example, you're trained as a nurse or a doctor, you don't want to just drive right by when you just see a pretty serious accident, because you can actually make the difference between someone living and someone dying. You know, also, the question is, you know, I'll throw another scenario. What happens if you see somebody getting robbed? Do you intervene? Do you stop what you're doing? You see this person, somebody trying to take a person's bag. Do you go and you intervene to try to stop that person, knowing that it's very possible that you can get hurt or even killed? I mean, I have to throw that out there. Killed for respecting or doing what you should morally do as a good person. You know,
yeah.
Today people are even afraid to drive people places because there have been situations where someone is stranded in the street. You feel as a moral person, as a good person, you want to go ahead and drop this person somewhere where they'll be safe. And then negative things happen to you or your family by taking this person to one place or another and the person actually turning on you. So moral obligation, I'm sorry, go ahead.
And also sometimes there are liabilities that can be you know, put upon you when you take on the responsibility. So it can be tricky. Yeah. Again, we are having a discussion and we are giving information, having a discussion, not advice. And so if anyone is experiencing some of these things, you want to make sure that you look up and follow any local ordinances, laws, and policies, and blah, blah. Go ahead. Oh, and then if you want join the discussion, please join us and call in again at 857-232-0159 and the PIN 473-012.
Thank you, Robin. Also, like Robin just mentioned, liabilities, very important. You know, a lot of people don't want to take on certain moral responsibilities because of the liabilities that may occur. I read a situation at one time where there was a house intruder that actually jumped through the roof of a person's house and literally landed and broke their leg. The owners of the house woke up, saw them there. They called the police, and subsequently the guy got arrested. But then he also went ahead and he sued the house owner for, you know, him getting his leg broken. And you say, well, wait a minute, you were trespassing. But there are loopholes and things to certain rules that can actually allow a person to be able to do things like that. And unfortunately, because of our legal system, these different things can go into the justice system. And sometimes these people who are immoral, in other words, not doing the right thing, can actually win these particular cases. And you'll be held liable for something that you say, listen, this wasn't my fault, it was out of my control, but because of certain states, certain countries, certain laws in different states and countries, these things can occur. So it can just be a really, really upsetting situation. But again, being that we're talking about moral obligation, I like to talk about what's your moral obligation as a person. And, you know, we live in the United States where, you know, all of us want, you know, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We all want to have good jobs. We want a house over our heads. We want a nice car. You know, we want the things that make us happy. And Michelle, actually, and I'm going to have her go into this in a little bit, she knows the different rules or the things that most people want in life. Besides that, there are others. There are basic necessities that people need, you know, basic food, you know, place over there, a shelter, things like that. So we all want to have those things in life. We want to make sure that our basic necessities are met. Because once our basic necessities are met, then we can function in a society. And unfortunately, in today's society, there's a lot of people whose basic necessities are not met. One of them is being healthcare. Right now, President Obama has been completely ridiculed and, criticized for a healthcare system that actually brings more healthcare to people who just don't have it. And he feels he has a moral obligation to help people who cannot get medical health care, whether because they don't have jobs or the proper amount of money to be able to afford it, to give certain people this health care system that will help them to, you know, live better lives. In other words, certain people live to just pay for health care for them, their family, their kids. He came out with this statute called Obamacare, where he changed certain laws. And right now, you know, I want to say most of the people who have health care are very angry about it. They feel that he's spending way too much money and it's causing a lot of harm, unfortunately, to their pockets. I'm going to just throw that out there because it is a money thing. You know, if it was free, I don't think anybody would complain. But unfortunately, you know, any type of service is going to cost money, and especially health care being one of the most lucrative businesses out there. Billions and billions of companies are making so much money from healthcare. It can cause, you know, a lot of different issues. And I think that's probably a good topic another day to discuss, you know, healthcare and, you know, how we as, you know, human beings pay for healthcare and how the whole healthcare system works. Because healthcare is one of those things that, you know, you have a lot of people making a lot of money off of it, and it can be considered immoral the way they're making it, because certain people need drugs to live, and because they need these drugs to live, they spend an absorbent amount of money, and you literally work all your life to, you know, pay for these drugs to keep you living. And it's like, how can your quality of life be good when you do certain things like that? So going back to values, as Michelle said earlier, We have, you know, everybody has a different value system, and a lot of it has to do with our upbringing. Everybody, you know, the United States is the biggest melting pot ever. You know, you have people from different countries, different areas of the world that have a lot of different sets of values. For example, you know, with Asian people, they want you to look at them in their eyes. If you don't look at them in your eyes when you greet them, it's kind of considered a form of disrespect. And if you don't know the different value systems of the different races and different, you know, ethnicities in this country, it can actually cause for different issues. So, you know, with that said, it changes the game. It changes certain things that happen in society. So, Robin, you want to give that number one more time? Anybody else want to join in and contribute?
I just wanted to point out three things about what you're saying, Marcus, and what everyone is saying within listening. And then I think Pastor Alan Holt also would like to chime in about moral obligations, because, again, as we identified, it has a lot to do with people's value system. And many a times, depending on the home a person comes out of, or depending on the teachings and the trainings and the cognitive skills that an individual has, it's going to weigh heavily, or the culture, or the religion, as I said before, it's going to weigh heavily on the persuasions people hold. And many of us are obeying the law because we have to, not because we want to. But there is a side of us where moral obligations is concerned that, and I will paraphrase it in this way, do unto others as you would have them to do to you. If you want people to treat you a certain way, if you want people to care about you a certain way, if you want people to have your back, and many of us look for security in having good friends, good family, good this, good that, and so we say, well, we expect a lot from people, but we don't want to give back. You know, we want people to do for us. We want people to be there for us. But we don't feel that we should have to do that. You know, reciprocity is not a word that many people use across the globe. And so one of the things about moral persuasion is that, and from what they're calling a theory called contractualism, it says it's a central claim that an act is right or wrong if and only if the act could or could not be justified to others on the grounds that they could not reasonably reject the act. So as we have mentioned a few items that recently was in the media, and some of these are popular ones like the Ferguson, the Trayvon. It could be something as simple as 200 police officers being fired in a community that really needs to have more police officers, and the government, the commissioners, the mayors are saying, we don't have enough money in the funding, while they make $1 million a year. And you go, what? Why don't they take a less salary and keep the police on force? Well, again, one of the scope of checking yourself is the thing I'm about to do, could it be reasonably rejected? Is it something that in the scope of the people that it's going to affect, they're going to reject it because by my actions, it created something for them or it resulted in something, not necessarily that I care about, that I call right or wrong, but perhaps that person, as a result of what I did, it was wrong. Let's take a simple case of a parent. Parents have an act to teach their children rules and value systems, and we teach them ethical behaviors and persuasions, and we tell our children not to steal and not to lie and not to, you know, so many laws. By the time a kid is two, it has been proven that they hear 500 no's. Because we love to tell them, no, don't do that, no, don't do that, no. And then when we look at our moral persuasions, we lie to children, say we're protecting them. And then we don't understand that we're teaching them to lie. We'll be fussy and argumentative and indisciplined, and then we'll want our children to be disciplined. So again, from the contractualism perspective, am I really being moral? There are two more perspectives that we should look at from a theory perspective, a philosophical perspective, is that moral obligation is more highly correlated with intention, more so than attitude or social norms. So just because socially it's okay to parade in the street and burn down your neighborhood because you're unhappy about something, is it really morally your obligation to do that? How does it affect the other people around you that are not involved in that act, who would rather see a civil resolution, whose homes and lives are now destroyed long after you jump back on a plane to your city, long after you go back to your house? Two women in Ferguson no longer have their business. So from a moral perspective, the intention, more so than the social norm, is what one can perceive and suggest that that act was not right. The third part is when we think of moral considerations, we know that moral considerations are necessary to predict behavioral intention in moral situations. So in other words, when I look at Cheryl and I think about Cheryl and I think about who she is, when I she reacts to certain things in life? Does she get so crazy that she tears up her house every time she's displeased about stuff? Does she go out and drink till she's drunk and now she's DUI, right? From a moral consideration, I can predict that based on intention of consistent destruction that she does, I can come to a conclusion that this person does not understand moral obligations to others. So if we are to truly have something in front of us, I am recommending that we look at these three pieces. We look at, is this something that I'm about to do that others can reject? Is this something that when I put it together with something else, the intention is matched up against attitude or social norms, does it not fit? Because your attitudes and beliefs are what lead you into the decisions you make. And so if my value system is poor already, based off the norms of the society, which would be the laws and the mores and all these things, if my attitude is already bad, then what are the chances I'm going to believe in values that would include others in me? No, because I'm selfish and it's all about me and my happiness and what my opinions are and what I prefer to do and how I prefer to do it and what gratifications I get from doing it. So why do I owe Marcus anything? I don't. And this is what we see, Marcus, today, everyone in our society. It's a gratitude of self-gratification that is excluding others in the decisions we make. And everything we do in life, I believe, affects people good or bad. If somebody needs to, I don't know, we're hearing a horn blowing, but everybody, I believe that everyone in life has a moral obligation, and this is one of those topics that definitely people need to examine themselves and say, how do I, in the scheme of life, how do I insert others? You know that there's no I in team. It's a we issue. I believe Mr. Daniel Sohn has a comment. He's burning up with fire. He has something he wants to say. So, Mr. Sohn.
I'm sorry. I just had to say this. You know, you started speaking about cities and municipalities and governments. Well, I found something very interesting. And you know, I didn't think about it today when we were sent the topic yet. But I mean about it. You know, there's a moral obligation bond. And for those that are unfamiliar with what a moral obligation bond, you can look it up, but I'll tell you briefly what it is. A moral obligation bond, when it is, it's kind of sort of it's a type of revenue bond issued by a municipality or town or a governmental entity. And what that means is a moral obligation bond gives the investors that the city is dealing with a tax exemption, as well as access to those benefits of that tax exemption. But it also provides those investors a pledge of commitment against default. So what I'm trying to, you can look it up to understand what I'm talking about. But there has been much controversy between municipalities as well as financial advisors in the past all over the country because of the name moral obligation bond. Simply because when it's your moral obligation, you're expected to maintain and keep that relationship as committed. Now, the funny thing, this is why the argument is started and why, whether this should be called a moral obligation, because intention is great when you intend to commit to something, you got to complete it. But it's a funny thing that municipalities, that when they create this moral obligation bond, it's said that they add additional security. But guess what? It's not legally binding. It's not a legal contract between the investor and the city. It's actually considered moral. So in court, it wouldn't hold up for them, even though it's on paper and it's dealing with money from a city to another agency. So even if one of the two parties failed to meet their moral obligation, it doesn't matter. It wouldn't matter legally. It's just that you said you would do it, you didn't do it. Guess what? All that money gets wasted. So, you know, there's been very a lot of controversy. My point with saying that is if we're going to say what moral obligation is, we have to be very clear that moral obligation is not just, and this is my opinion, is not just something we say. It's got to be something we follow through with. If we are, we call something, if we use the word lightly and say, that is my moral obligation, you can't be found doing it, doing the opposite of that. You got to continue and be straightforward and maintain what you said is your moral obligation. Your moral obligation today cannot be your, not be your moral obligation tomorrow in another place, in another environment, in another situation. I just wanted to say that.
Uh-oh. We appreciate it, Daniel. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I don't know if that made any sense, but there's been a lot of controversy, just so you all know, between what a moral obligation bond is between municipalities and finance and investors, whether that word or that type of, if you will, agreement should be called a moral obligation because it's not legally binding in the court of law. And it doesn't matter. The city can give investors all this money, but they don't have to keep their side of the bargain, so their commitment. And because it's not legally binding, it's considered moral. So all that money is lost. So my point with saying that, I'm going to say clarify it again. So those listeners that didn't understand, my personal take on that is, and based off what I just described, is that if you are going to say something, is your moral obligation, you're going to do something for then it's got to be what you do in every situation. It can't change per situation. So my moral obligation is to help the needy, okay, and the less fortunate. That means if I am fall on hard times, but there's someone who's in a worse condition than me, I cannot no longer say that is not my obligation to help them. I need to help them because they're less fortunate than I am at the moment. So that's what I wanted to say. That your moral, that you can't take those words lightly. They're very serious words.
No, that makes sense, Daniel. We appreciate the comment. You know, and as we're talking here, I just wanted to bring Mr. Alan Holt on the line because he's also a pastor, and Pastor Holt can actually speak more of the godly moral values, the values that we feel we all should follow in a godly sense. Pastor, are you on the phone?
I am. Thank you very much. You know, what I like to contribute to the call tonight, I always try to get the heart of the presenter. You know, there are certain reasons why certain topics resonate and why certain topics are discussed. I happen to believe that, you know, things happen in our lives for a reason. that we must also be very purposeful in everything that we do. And of course, God says we're going to give an account for the conversations and the discussions and the things that we consider. So what I like to do, and certainly I'll put a spiritual spin on it, if it were, but can you say, as a developer of, this is to you, Mr. Dean, as a developer of this specific topic, I mean, what was the driving force behind choosing this particular topic? What was the heart? What was the what sparked it, if it were, that you might choose such a topic such as this?
Well, the real reason why I decided to choose this topic is because recently in the news, you know, we have a lot of public figures, a lot of people that, you know, we look up to, and that, unfortunately, in my opinion, the news usually tends to be negative. A lot of the news has resonated off the negative things that publicity artists or public presenters or people do. The one that strikes me right now is Bill Cosby. I'm a huge Bill Cosby fan, loved him from way back. And basically, with all of these allegations of what he's been doing recently, it started me thinking, like, when you're in a public eye and you have public figure, you're a public figure, now do you have a moral obligation to do certain things that you know, correctly? And the thing is that that's kind of what made me start thinking about, you know, the way some of these artists and these people that, you know, me and other people look up to, what type of obligation do they have being a public figure? So that's actually what caused me to come up with this idea.
Very good. Very good question. As you think about that, are they or should they be more responsible than the average parent, than the average citizen, the average child, or the average person walking in our neighborhoods every day?
Well, that's a good question because, you know, as I'm a person that has kids, I feel that I have to definitely be, you know, I have a moral obligation to be good because I am their influence. They look to me before they look at anybody else. However, they also are influenced by public figures as well. And for example, my daughter happens to love an artist called Ariana Grande, which is a new artist that came out. She's been around for a while and she's a singer, but the way she sings is great. However, she performs in a very, I don't want to use the word provocative, but in very short clothing, and she always wears these real tight fitted outfits that, you know, I'm thinking now, will my daughter now want to start wearing these type of outfits and start, you know, administering her sexuality because one of the people that she looks up to is doing it?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I understand that quite well. And if you were to take the perspective of the person that is in the spotlight or always being in the public's view, they will tell you they don't want the responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, they will tell you that you should be the greatest contributor of values in your home with your children, so on and so forth. And as parents, because we realize that there are external pressures, that requires us to do all we can, first and foremost, to live right, to be the right example, because, you know, we know that kids will do what they see us do. So, do what I say, not what I do. But today, people don't respect that.
Yeah.
They will respect who you are and what you do. And as a result of that, we have the first responsibility, you know, starts at home. It starts with me. It starts with each and every individual. And we cannot expect that other people are going to buy in to that level of belief like we have. So whether or not they buy into it or not, I am going to be consistent. Whether or not they love the songs of these artists and they love the videos, I am going to be consistent. And it's not until we become consistent that we actually can stand and demand that there is responsibility. But it starts with us. If we're not going to be consistent, we cannot expect our kids to honor it. We cannot expect society to honor it, and especially anybody that's high profile, given all the things that, you know, they have to deal with in their lives as well. So I wanted to know kind of what your heart was behind it, and I really appreciate, you know, what you're saying about guys like Bill and, you know, other profile, high-profile people. Do you remember, Marcus, many years ago when I know it was Charles Barkley, who I love. You know, I think he's candid. I think he's honest, sometimes, you know, at his own expense. But he's a straight shooter, and he's going to tell you what's really on his heart. And I can deal with a person like that rather than the person who's deceptive, who will not be forthright and just be, you know, brutally honest with me. But he would say it. I'm not your role model. Don't look to me to be the example for your children. Dad, you be the example. Mom, you be the example, right?
Yeah.
But where are we taught? Where is a person taught moral obligation? Well, maybe you can respond to that.
In church, and unfortunately, a lot of people don't go to church as much as they used to, or they go to church and unfortunately they don't get that type of education. And I think, Robin, you wanted to have a comment. I know you want to probably chime in on that.
We send our kids to school and expect for them to come out educated. But we still have the responsibility. It's still our responsibility that our children come out educated. And that entails understanding what they're exposed to and all that, which many of us parents go to. We can't even tell you what our children's curriculum is, and we can't even tell you what kind of perspective that their teachers are coming from. And then also with media, see, we also put our kids in front of the media with the tablets, the Xboxes, the 360s, all whatever. And then in school, I didn't know, but in school they're giving preschoolers tablets. So there's a systematic dumbing down as well. And then even in we would want to send people to the churches and for wisdom, but a lot of times, just like in the government and schools, you get the people that are giving out information from a slant for different agendas, maybe to generate money or who knows what else, power control, who knows what else. So again, the ultimate responsibility, it does come down to the parent. And then when it comes to operating moral obligation or good character, then that still stems, it goes down to each person individually. And even a baby, even a child, they know when they do something wrong. And they will try to either cover it up or they lie, you know, the little darlings, or they'll fess up so they can get it right. But even a child. So there is that age of accountability, okay, even from children's age, where we can be self accountable, you see? And the law, watch this. The word says the law is for the lawless. And then we have to remember, see, we go into the laws, we always go, when the uproar happens, well, why didn't the police do something? Why didn't the laws? But and we've got rights. Well, we have to remember, watch this. We were given a bill of rights, not given them. We were given a bill of rights. So we don't even have rights. You see, and then the rights that we have are to protect us from what? The government. So I'm just saying all that, not to point a slant on the government or any other agency like that, but just again, the ultimate responsibility, we have to start looking towards ourselves and not others. You know, we have to be our own models. Yeah.
You said something, and I laughed a little bit, and because, you know what, I'm not trying to put anything on the government either, but I laugh because I kind of agree with you. How can we expect when our own government, like I talked about the moral bond, is willing to say, well, I made a commitment to you, I signed it, but it's because I said it's moral, it doesn't matter that I signed a contract with you.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So Pastor's question, I believe, was, also, you know, should we hold these public figures more accountable in a higher regard? I don't think the answer is yes. I don't think the answer is no. But I think the answer is that we have the responsibility to, as parents, as leaders in the community, as a, someone who sees something in their neighborhood that is wrong, but without passing judgment, or using stereotypes, I think it is our responsibility to seek out the ways that we can hold those people accountable. Sometimes that may not be us physically doing something about it. They may be making a phone call to our local police department, you know, being vigilant. It may be, you know, not taking action ourselves, or it may be, you know, seeing a parent smack their children a little too hard, but, you know, it may be saying, you know, be just mindful of that. Maybe not taking action, but I think the responsibility is on everyone, not just a specific party or group. You know,
right.
We all know right from wrong.
Definitely.
But,
everybody in society. I'm sorry, Ms. Farrell, did you have to say something?
If I can just interject here.
Yes.
We have to understand where we begin as human beings, where we come out of the birth canal. Values begin at home. Children discover parents' values by observing how the parents spend their most precious resources, which is their time and their money. So if a parent fills their day with work, TV, shopping, home maintenance, hanging out, talking on the phone, all of these things, then most of the time your kids are watching you and they perceive that your habits and your behaviors, what you say, not being the word and your bond, the different things you believe children are not seeing, they begin to pick this up as old family values. And this is what they then go out. So let's get the hierarchy properly here. A child does not go into popular culture when they're 0 to 5 and 10. They do not get involved with popular culture when they're newborn. So the first onset or onslaught of values, moral teachings, is in the home. Children observe you, and based off what they see, not what you say, is how they begin to pick up habits. Their characteristics are formed from in the home. Once they get to a certain age, 0 to 10, after 10 years old, because they're now in school at 5, some of them are, most people are, they begin to hang with what's called their peers, who have different value systems. And so as young kids in kindergarten coming up, they begin to form about their genders and different things, because these are things that happen in different homes. Some kids believe in Santa. Some homes don't teach Santa Claus. So when the kid goes to school and says Santa Claus, my kid may say, there is no such thing. What do you mean there's no such thing? My mom says Santa Claus is a myth. That Santa Claus is just a fairy tale because daddy is Santa Claus. How many times have your children quoted you? How many times have you heard them say, my dad says, my mother says? So you're the first thing, the first impregnation into their spirit. Then their peers started to impregnate them. And if, for some reason, you did not do what you were supposed to have done, because you were lying, cheating, and stealing, pretending to believe in philosophies you didn't believe in, then these philosophies get shattered when the peers challenge it. As you know, when the peers start saying, well, how can you, your folks say you can't lie, but so and so. Now the kids start saying, that makes a lot of sense. So now the peers start influencing them. And when the peers start influencing them, those of us who take our children to churches, and those of us who have social groups in different settings outside of family, immediate family is what I'm talking about, our children begin to observe everything around us, including what the preacher says. And when they start observing these things, if you are consistent, if you believe in the gospel, you believe in the moral compass of the Bible, then it confirms to the child what you have told them at home. So your moral compass would be exactly what God has said in his word. But if your moral compass is strictly about the physical, and not incorporating the spiritual, then the child begins to question a lot of stuff, which is why so many people, by the time they get to be 15, 16, or even 17, they don't want to go to church anymore. And then parents allow it because they go, I can't force them into church. And so what happens is a progression, a progressive state. Politics has nothing to do with this. Popular culture has nothing to do with this. The reason our children are led astray is because when they were first starting out, as I said on Saturday in my Classy Lady training, it may take a village to raise a child, but it takes a community to do a generation. And so when we forget simple rules and simple bylaws, what happens is our children begin to question the status. They begin to try and, as it were, manipulate the rules. But if we're consistent on the beliefs that we have, not because they are norms, but they are embedded in even us, challenge yourself, everyone, in this call. How many moral things your parents told you that you still hold dear today? How many parents were brought up in church that don't go anymore? How many of us were told not to curse, yet we curse like it's out of style? How many of us were told that your role is supposed to be this, and we're far from what we were ever taught? So it's the same for the children. So moral persuasion begins in the family, it begins at home, and then throughout the compass, if you came up in a chaotic family, chances are your moral persuasions are chaotic. If you are brought up in a steady, steadfast home where no means no and yes means yes, then chances are you are going to be a person that's what they call the high achiever mentality, the A personality, where things have to be in order, things have to go a certain way. Most of those kind of people become scientists, go to the military, they teach, they do certain things because they were brought up in a certain way. And even though they stray, they don't go very far from what they were taught. So when we think about our children and why is it that someone has a greater impact on them than we do, chances are we used to sing songs around them that we shouldn't have. Chances are we listened to music that they thought, oh, and now that they've gotten bigger, they feel okay to have their own choice for music because you said it was okay to do it when they were small. They heard you saying these things. So, you know, when it comes to politics and government, the government should not have more control over your home than you. You cannot ask other people, and you cannot put your children over to other people to take charge of them because you can't do it. You know, a lot of us do that as parents. We want everybody else to be responsible for the negative piece, but when little Johnny gets a scholarship and he gets a big award, that's me. That's all me. That's what I did. But when little Johnny does something wrong, that's not me. That's Dad. Dad did that. It wasn't me. And so we need as adults to take accountability for our children and take responsibility for the moral pieces that we're doing. Moral obligations begin with value systems, and value systems begin in the home. I believe, Marcus, it is now 6:56 and we have to go to the Bible study piece. So I believe you as the moderator and mediator of this call have the final discussion on here, and perhaps this is something I think is a dynamic topic that if we streamline it the way we have done, it's up to you, Marcus. This may be something that we want to talk some more about because this is a serious topic. It can help so many people to understand certain things and certain beliefs, but that would be up to you if you want to
something make great. You're absolutely right. Before we run off this phone call, and thanks again, Ms. Cheryl, I really wanted to get Pastor to say his last word because he did ask, you know, about social, you know, how us in the home can be role models. So, Pastor, for 1 minute, can you just finish elaborating what you were stating?
Absolutely. We have to understand that the Bible is very clear that we are here to be fruitful and to multiply. In the beginning, God created us in his image and in his likeness, and he said it was good that man was functioning like he was created to function. And God, who is most responsible, produces sons who are also very responsible, who realize they have an obligation. They have an obligation to represent him in the highest esteem so that the Father might be honored in how well they live. That comes when there's a reverence of God in the lives of people. And many people who don't have that reverence you know, tend to take life in their own hands and to be subject to their own rules. But there is a ruler who is greater than all rulers. There is a king who is greater than all kings. And there's a Lord who's greater than all lords. And that is the one who we serve, who has given us the right and has given us the responsibility, if it were, to represent his name well. So if we're conscious or are conscious of that reality, we will represent him in truth. We will represent him in integrity. And we will model, we will follow Christ. And the Bible says that as we follow him, when we're following him correctly, our children and our children's children and our children's children's children will also follow Christ as they follow us who are leading them to Christ. So that is our responsibility, not the responsibility of the great artists that are out there who we appreciate their work, right? But they're fallen men. They're not perfect in any regard, but Christ himself is perfect, and he's given us the model, so therefore we have no excuse. I love the topic. I believe that we can continue to break great ground in this area, and that if we continue it, you know, that there'll be more fruit that will come forth from it. And the last point is that a good tree produces good fruit. That's what the word says. That a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. And that every tree that does not produce will be cut down and cast into the fire. That's what the word of the Lord said. And therefore, those that do produce his fruit, God's going to honor, and it will always be fruitful and able to supply abundantly to all that are in need. Thank you for the call.
Thank you, Pastor. We really appreciate it. Now, for the people left on the phone call, what I think this is a great topic, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to tell everybody we will continue this conversation next week, Wednesday at 6. Currently, it's 7 o'clock. We're going to all go to the Bible study call. Robin, can you give that number for anybody who's listening who likes to go into Bible study, that number in 10, please?
Mm-hmm. Yes, that number is...
Robin, I have it. I have it if you need it. It's 712.
There it is.
Yes.
432. 0700. I'm sorry, I thought you had it on hand. And the PIN is 970516 pound. But I repeat it, 712-432-0700. PIN number 970516 pound. I'd like to thank everybody for the input, Pastor Holt, Ms. Cheryl, Daniel Song, and, of course, Robin, as always, we always appreciate the time. We're going to all go into the Bible study right now. But, again, next week we will be talking about moral obligations, part two. And we look forward to everybody being on the call and having a great, great discussion. If there's not anything else, we will reconvene next week. Take care, everybody, and God bless.
All right, everyone listening in on Spreaker, stay tuned and refresh because we're going to be back in 2 minutes with Families in Distress Bible Study. Okay, thanks, everyone.
You are listening to the Gospel Music Explosion with Minister Robin Lynn.
You are the air I breathe. Hallelujah. Good morning, good morning. You've got Minister A Minute with Minister Maven. That's me, Minister Robin Lynn. We're going to get right into it. We are on a journey of understanding the Holy Spirit. I will be here every day teaching on understanding the Holy Spirit. Let us go boldly before the throne of grace and mercy. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we are so glad, glad, glad. You said, enter your courts with thanksgiving and with praise. So here we are, singing your praises all day long. Father God, we thank you for the Holy Spirit that leads and guides us into all truth. All wisdom comes from above. I pray that we all pick up what you're putting down. I pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. And our scripture today, oh Lord, is coming from, oh Jesus, I done lost it again. I always do this. Jesus Christ, Lord help me. Okay, here we go. It's coming from Psalms 140, verses 12 and 13, which says, I know that the Lord will maintain the cause of the afflicted and the right of the poor. Surely the righteous shall give thanks unto thy name. The upright shall dwell in thy presence. Hallelujah. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing and the doing of his word. All right. So today we're going to be trying to look at some everyday questions and answers about the Holy Spirit. Amen? All right. Now, I, as a minister, I've been asked many questions concerning the Holy Spirit. okay? That lets me know that there's a lot of people out there with unanswered questions on the Holy Spirit, okay? And in learning more about the Holy Spirit, I realized that I can't gain understanding of the Holy Spirit by based on what I've heard or even what I thought, okay? I had to go to the Bible and see what the Bible actually said, all right? All right, and if the Bible was quiet on a particular subject, meaning it didn't say, okay, we can't insert our own opinion. Father says, lean not to thine own understanding, okay? So all the answers that we're looking, okay, that we'll be going through, they're all coming from the Bible. They're all biblically based with scripture references. All right, so here we go. One question that's asked is, when do you receive the Holy Spirit? When do you receive the Holy Spirit? Now, this question assumes that there are two separate events that happen in the life of a Christian. One is that he or she gets saved, and the other is that he or she receives the Holy Spirit. But are these two separate events really supported by the Word of God? Ephesians 1 and 13 says, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. This passage would indicate that at the moment one believes in Christ, becomes saved, he becomes sealed with the Holy Spirit. If you look at the same passage in the New Living Translation, it makes this point even clearer. And now you must also have heard the truth, the good news that God saves you. And when you believed in Christ, he identified you as his own by giving you the Holy Spirit, whom he promised you long ago. At the very moment of accepting Christ, he accepts us as his own and identifies us or seals us as his through the Holy Spirit. As a matter of fact, there are several scriptures that indicate that we must have the Holy Spirit in order to be saved. Romans 8 and 9 says, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you, now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Now look at this same verse over in the Contemporary Version. But you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. And remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them are not Christians at all. Now, this is not my opinion. This is a passage in the Holy Bible that clearly states that if we do not have the Holy Spirit, we do not belong to Christ. An individual may still be a babe in Christ, not demonstrating the life of a mature Christian, but in order to accept Christ, they had to have had the Holy Spirit. Okay? Amen. Revelations 3 and 20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. The picture painted here by Christ himself is that the Holy Spirit comes to live in us when we open up the doors of our heart. The moment we accept Christ, the Holy Spirit comes to live in us. There is no waiting period, no begging period, no tarrying period. A person receives the Holy Spirit from the very moment they accept Christ and believe in him, according to Romans 10 and 9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Have you received the Holy, and this is another question, here we go. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Now, this is This question is one that comes from the Holy Bible directly. On the surface of things, it would indicate that a person could believe and not have the Holy Spirit. He said unto them, Have ye received the Holy Ghost since ye believed? And they said unto him, We have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. Thus, many have taken this passage to mean that we could be saved and not have the Holy Spirit. However, the reality is that the people referred to in this passage were not truly saved. Acts 19:3 says, And he said unto them, Unto what then were ye baptized? And they said, Unto John's baptism. These men were John the Baptist disciples who had not come into the knowledge of Christ. They couldn't have been saved because Christ is the only way to God. Jesus is the only name whereby men may be saved. The moment you accept Christ, the Holy Spirit comes to live in you, seal you, and baptize you in the body of believers, into the body of believers. Paul recognized that this had not happened to these people, and thus explained to them what it meant to be saved. Okay? In the next verses, Acts 19:4-5, Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Once they accepted the message of Jesus Christ, they became saved and received the Holy Spirit. Acts 19:6-7, And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake in tongues and prophesied. And all the men were about 12. Now please note that once they accepted Jesus Christ, they received the Holy Spirit. The reason these men did not have the Holy Spirit before was not because they needed to tarry or wait for him. It was because they had not accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. Another question is, do you lose the Holy Spirit when you sin? Now this is a very powerful question, and it boils down to what happens when we sin. The incorrect answer to this question is responsible for a lot of people not being saved or even in the church today. Okay? A good way to answer, I believe, is to first look at how we receive the Holy Spirit. If you recall, when we receive the Holy Spirit at the moment that we accept Christ according to Ephesians 1:13 and Revelations 3:20. Let's look at both of these scriptures again. Galatians 1:13 says, In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. What I want you to notice in looking at these scriptures is that there is no mention of sin. In other words, the Holy Bible never says for us to give up sin in order to receive the Holy Spirit. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying here concerning sin. I am not an advocate of once saved, always saved doctrine. Okay, as a matter of fact, God clearly does not want us to sin. He hates all sin. Okay, Romans 6:1-2 says, What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin, that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we, that are dead to sin, live any longer therein? We were saved, not because we stopped sinning, but because of God's grace. We were justified in the sight of God through the death of Jesus on the cross, and thus received the gift of salvation and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Our lack of sinning did not save us and cannot save us. As a matter of fact, God says that any righteousness that we could muster up would still be as filthy rags to him anyway. Okay? That's in Isaiah 64:6. All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. Mm-hmm. A gift is something that one receives free of charge. If we had to work for the Holy Spirit, then it would no longer be a gift. If I tell you that I'm going to give you a gift of $100, but then ask you first to clean my house before I give it to you, then the $100 is no longer a gift, but a wage for services rendered. We do not earn the Holy Spirit because he is not a wage. He is a gift. As a matter of fact, there is not enough we could ever do to earn the Holy Spirit. So God gave us the Holy Spirit as a gift. The Holy Spirit did not come to us because we stopped sinning. He came to us because we accepted God's gift of salvation. Jeremiah 3:14 says, "Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married unto you, and I will take you, one of a city, two of a family, and I will bring you to Zion." The Holy Spirit lives in us so he can lead us, guide us, and teach us all things. A teacher is there to teach you, not just when you do things right, but also when you make mistakes. If the Holy Spirit left us every time we sinned, how could he ever teach us? Now, here is what is supposed to happen when we sin. 1 John 2:1-12. "My dear children, I am writing this to you so that you will not sin. But if you do sin, there is someone to plead for you before the Father. He is Jesus Christ, the one who pleases God completely. He is the sacrifice for our sins. He takes away not only our sins, but the sins of all the world." Sin does not forfeit us from the Holy Spirit, no more than a child is forfeited from his family when he misbehaves. But when that child is bad, he simply says to his parents, "I'm sorry." And so it is with us Christians. If we sin, we simply say to Father, "I'm sorry," and he forgives us. Next question, what does it mean to be filled with the Holy Spirit? Okay, when does a person receive... we just discussed when a person receives the Holy Spirit, and we learned that the Holy Spirit enters our heart when we accept Jesus Christ, okay? As a matter of fact, according to Romans 8, we do not belong to Christ unless we have the Holy Spirit. But this question deals with the filling of the Holy Spirit. I believe that a person can have the Holy Spirit and not yet be filled with the Holy Spirit. To be filled with the Holy Spirit means to be totally controlled by the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 5:18, "Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit." The New Living Translation actually uses the word control when referring to being filled with the Holy Spirit. Ephesians says, "Don't be drunk with wine because that will ruin your life. Instead, let the Holy Spirit fill and control you." Now, this passage in the Bible uses a metaphor to describe what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. It first says to be not drunk with wine. When a person is drunk with wine, the wine controls them. They begin to do things that they would not ordinarily do. A quiet and reserved person all of a sudden becomes the life of the party or very rowdy. The wine is now controlling their behavior. So what the scripture is saying is that when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, he will control your behavior. You will begin to do things that you would not ordinarily have done. For example, Jesus said that we should love our enemies. Well, most people, saved or unsaved, are incapable of doing this. But when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, you can. Now, if you recognize being filled with the Holy Spirit as being controlled by the Holy Spirit, it would explain why the behavior of some Christians differ from that of others. The Holy Bible supports this concept and calls it being a babe in Christ. 1 Corinthians 3, 1 and 3 says, 1 through 3, "And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet are ye now able. For ye are yet carnal, for whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, called haters, and ye are not carnal, and walk as men. Are ye not carnal?" Okay. Now look at the third verse in the New Living Translation. "If you are still controlled by your own sinful nature, you are jealous." Okay, if you are still controlled by your own sinful desires, "for you are still controlled by your own sinful desires. You are jealous of one another and quarrel with each other. Doesn't that prove you are controlled by your own desires? You are acting like people who don't belong to the Lord." Now please note that a babe in Christ is not necessarily a person that just got saved. It is a person who is not being controlled by the Spirit, but by their sinful fleshly desires. When we move from being a babe in Christ to being a mature Christian, when the Holy Spirit is controlling us. But also, please note that a Christian filled with the Holy Spirit can move back into being a babe in Christ if they allow their sinful nature to move back into the control of their lives. This is why I say that being filled with the Holy Spirit is not a one-time even signified event, signified by speaking in tongues or some other outward event, but by the ongoing demonstration of a lifestyle controlled by the Spirit. And just as a car must constantly go and get filled with gas, we must do the things necessary to constantly get filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Okay, we're going to wrap that up for today, and we'll come back tomorrow and pick up right where we left off. I pray that we are all enlightened, empowered, and blessed. Stay strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. That is my prayer. All right, and we will see everyone tomorrow. God bless you.
God's been good to me.
God's been good to me.
God's been
really good to me.
Showing up good to me.
Showing up good to me. I just can't tell it all.
I just can't tell it all. There's been times in my life when I didn't do everything just right, but I know that God has.
Showing up good to me. I just can't tell it all. So good.
Hallelujah.
Really, really good to me. Showing up good to me. I just can't tell it all.
There's been times I can say that things should have gone the other way, but God didn't see fit to let it be. I can't let a single day go by to raise my hands up to the sky and give God some thanks for blessing me. Hey!
God's been good to me.
God's been good to me.
Really, really good to me.
So good.
Sure enough good to me. I just can't tell it all. So good.
Hallelujah.
Really,
really, really good to me. Showing up good to me.
I just
just can't tell all. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you. Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you. I thank God for saving me. Hallelujah. Good to me. Really, really good to me. I sure enough good to me. I just can't tell it all. Really, really good to me. Shown up good to me.
I just can't tell it all. Really, really good to me. Shown up good to me. I just can't tell it all.
What if you didn't follow the path everyone else takes? Would you rather make your own way or spend your life saying, what if? Life is calling. How far will you go? Peace Corps. To find out more, call 1-800-424-8580 or go to peacecorps.gov.
Guess right. 30 years ago.
We were doing it first, but
and it just happened. You know, we had a great collaboration between parties. The Nike Jordan relationship that was started in '85 has evolved 30 years later, and we would have never guessed 30 years later we would still be doing things like this. But the beauty of it is that we have a great working relationship. We have a great understanding, and when you have that type of relationship, you never know how long it's going to last. Anything's possible. And we've proven that 30 years later that anything's possible, that we've been able to connect with that consumer 30 years later and still going strong.
Twitter CEO Dick Costolo is out. Jack Dorsey, the co-founder, chairman, and former CEO, is back in, at least on a temporary basis. Twitter has been just
been a mess.
Crazy. Leadership futility, a lot of revolving doors. Now three CEOs are going to be sitting on the board.
Yeah, that'll make it hard to hire a new one, to put it lightly. Perhaps Jack will stay. The problem is that Twitter, it's complicated because of its past, basically. In most other tech companies, you have a charismatic founder who owns a big chunk of the stock, and then that's able, like, you know, think of Facebook, for instance, Zuckerberg. He has absolute control. He can do whatever he wants. With Twitter, you had this really complicated situation where Costolo only had 1% of the company, basically.
Right.